you haven't discerned, I'm Dr. Dave Schofield. I'm the music director here at the church. You are going to need your hymnal for this, because as it turns out, a lot of the hymns that I'm going to be talking about are still in the hymnal, and I'm going to refer to that. So I think it's just, this is actually, we do use this book, we just don't use it in the service. We don't have you take it out of the pew, but a lot of the selections that we use are from here. And it is a compendium of church music over the last, well, from early. There were some chants here from 5th, 6th century. So, yeah. All right. So, as we begin to look at Luther's Revolution, from a musical cultural standpoint, I have a disclaimer to make right off the bat. It seems I bit off a big chunk, a really big chunk. And the challenge of preparing this presentation was, quickly became not to say, not what to say, but what not to say. So there aren't necessarily huge gaping lacuna in my talk, but I've tried to focus on things that would best illustrate the emerging culture Luther created and how it changed the course of things. All else had to be put to the side. So here we go. The advent of the Reformation brought with it ideas of populism. If the Bible was to be translated so that all who knew how to read could read it in the vernacular, then new ideas about what this compilation of texts known as the Bible might mean would naturally arise. For not everyone had a seminary training, but they could now read the texts themselves and have their own ideas and opinions about them. The church's authority over heresy would be challenged. Personal taste became more and more important, as institutionally held ideas were constantly scrutinized. This would eventually lead to the Pietist movement and a personal savior, Jesus and me, sort of spirituality, which had not existed in any popular way previously. But that's hundreds of years after Martin Luther posted his thesis, so let's save that thought for another time. Our story begins not in Wittenberg, but in Rome. Luther was ordained in 1507, and in 1510, he was chosen to represent the German Augustinian monasteries on a mission to Rome. It was on this journey he discovered the amazing compositions of Josquin des Prez. The Franco-Flemish composer's motets were particularly innovatory, and his natural word setting made a big impression on Luther. Luther came to admire Josquin's polyphony. He famously said of Josquin, quote, the other song masters are forced to do as the notes determine. Now, Josquin is the master of the notes, and they must do as he wills. Luther took a leaf out of Desprez's book when he wrote, quote, both text and notes, accent and melody, and manner of rendering ought to grow out of the true mother tongue and its inflection. Josquin was the leading musical figure of the age and was a singer-composer in the Cappella Sistina, the Sistine Chapel Choir, which was undisputedly the premier musical ensemble of all Europe. The style of composition was florid polyphony. Let's listen to a bit of Josquin's Missa Pange Lingua, and this would have been sung in the Sistine Chapel, based upon a Latin hymn tune of the same name and written for the Sistine Chapel. This hymn tune is in our hymnals at number 355. Let's turn to it quickly. It's translated, of course. The text is originally by Ambrose. But it's still in chant form. Okay. So you just need to know the beginning to understand the music we're about to hear. So a little of the
Thank you.
I'm going to be just giving you little snippets of all of these examples. If we listened to the whole thing, we'd be here till midnight. So, and if you want to go back when you get home, you can look it up on YouTube and listen to it yourself. So, this is the kind of thing that was church music in any large church or chapel. That's what it sounded like at the time that Luther became a priest. So it's good to bear in mind that the Sistine Chapel was a brand new building in 1510. Michelangelo began his painting the famous fresco on the ceiling in 1508 and finished it in 1512. It's no wonder that someone as gifted as Luther, both in intellect and music, not that the two are necessarily exclusive, was so affected by the great religious artistic undertakings he experienced in Rome. Luther even went so far as to write what today might be called tribute songs in the style of Jaspin. One famous extant manuscript is Luther's setting of his favorite text, Non morir sed vivam et narum opera domini. I shall not die but live and declare the works of the Lord. And I think I have a piece of music. You can look it up online. It sounds very much like the piece we just heard. Going back and forth between the videos and the presentations. A little cumbersome, sorry. So, as affected as Luther was by the art and architecture he found in Rome, he was even more affected by the irreverence of the clergy. The city, which he had greeted as holy, was a sin of iniquity under Julius II. Its priests were openly infidel and scoffed at the services they performed. The people courtiers were men of the most shameless lives, and he was accustomed to repeat the Italian proverb. I love this. If there is a hell, Rome is built over it. In my studies in the Sistine Chapel choir some years ago, I came across a written eyewitness journal account of a party thrown by Leo X. So this was written by someone who attended the party. Leo X, whom my students gleefully referred to as the party pope. Leo became pope after Julius died in 1513, and he was 14. He was a Florentine. Not the cookie. Actually born in Florence. Okay. Being Florentine, he was brought to power by the Medicis. The writer recalls a party he attended at the Vatican to celebrate a visit by the Medici patriarch. There was a sumptuous, rather drunken banquet. Leo brought the entire Sistine Chapel choir, some 20 singers, dressed them all as doctors, because Medici means medic or doctor, and had them sing newly composed secular motet with a text praising the Medicis both as a profession and as a family, with some clever interplay between the two themes. This was the entertainment for the evening. Musically, this was not worthy because it was not only customary, it was not customary to have four singers on the part. Two at the most, and usually one on the part was the norm. And so this was a very extravagant moment. The slide that I've shown portrays the infamous banquet of chestnuts given by Julius II in 1501, where the candles were extinguished and all present ended up naked on the floor. Several eyewitness accounts. So in any case, this sort of expensive and licentious revelry was commonplace and illustrates well the unholy but politically astute attitudes Luther encountered in Rome. Surely this trip was pivotal for Luther's ideas and the emergence of the Reformation.
Swiss guard.
Meanwhile, back in Wittenberg, Luther posts his 95 theses and the Reformation begins. Liturgically and musically, the Reformation sought to make public worship more accessible to the common woman and man. Translating the lectionary, offering the sermon, and many of the prayers in the vernacular made the liturgy what sermons more needed. Musically, the Reformation needed canticles, psalms, and songs that the whole church could gather and could sing at once. Thus, the metrical hymn was fashioned, a style using a steady beat and a poetic verse of regular meter to facilitate large groups singing together. Melodies were adopted from chant repertory or freely borrowed from popular secular songs or newly composed. These melodies were mostly syllabic, one note per syllable. Almighty fortress is our God. And avoided wide volume skips, preferring scalar phrases and generally within the tessitura of an octave. So, taking that same hymn, God, Almighty fortress is our God, and now we go down the scale. One octave, right? This could certainly be described as dumbing down when compared to the contemporary liturgical music by Jean Scanlon, whom Luther openly admired. Nonetheless, this repertory of new metrical hymnody eventually took root and spawned some of the greatest music in Western tradition to date. I refer, of course, to the Bach cantatas, but there was a whole school of Northern European composers during the 17th and 18th century who produced great music for the church based upon these hymn melodies. The way that these melodies took root was first by publication of hymnals. The printing press was a new technology, and much has been said about the dissemination of Luther's German Bible through the publication. Hymnals were no different. Suddenly, it was possible to write hymns, print collections, and distribute them for use far and wide at a reasonable cost. Previously, the chant repertory was passed down by oral tradition and meticulously scribed in manuscripts that were costly to produce and could be accessed only by select cantors. As the use of the printing press and the Reformation occurred simultaneously, hymnals could now be had relatively cheaply, even purchased for use in one's home. The Achliebuch, literally eight song book, was the first Lutheran hymn. It was printed in 1523 and 1524 in Nuremberg by Jobst Gunecht, although the title page shows Wittenberg as location of the print. That's the title page. That's where the hymn is. So, as it turns out, a number of these hymns are still in our red hymnals. So let's see. First one, when Freudberg do Christian Mind is 594. As Hass as High and Common Hair is 442. And with a rhythmic version, the original rhythm notation at 590. And the Aus Tiefen Not at 600. So I'm not going to dwell on any of those right now because I have to focus on several. Again, we'll be here till midnight. But just so you know, they're there. Okay. We can't all be happy people, I guess. Let's look briefly at another of these important publishers, Georg Rapp. I was born in Franconia and attended the University of Wittenberg, which was the center of publishing and reform. He apprenticed at the Wittenberg printing establishment of Rau Grunenberg with his uncle, and subsequently opened his own publishing house also in Wittenberg. Rau was a trained and accomplished musician and composer. In 1518, he was appointed cantor at the Thomasschule and Thomaskirche in Leipzig, post that J.S. Bach held some 2 years later, 200 years later. Many of his compositions were presumably written to be sung for the services by the choir at St. Thomas. The These were primarily polyphonic choral pieces in Latin for the ordinary, the mass, and canticles. It was during Rau's years at St. Thomas that the famous Leipzig debate occurred, which was a disputation between Johann Eck and Wittenberg reformers Andreas Karlstadt and Martin Luther. Rau wrote a 12-voice Missa de Santo Spiritu and a Te Deum for the occasion, but these are unfortunately not preserved. This debate was Rau's first significant encounter with the Reformation, and he was forced to resign his post in Leipzig because of his adherence to Luther's teachings. He returned to Wittenberg and began publishing Reformation materials. Thus, printed music and hymns became readily available. The advantages are obvious. One's not so obvious disadvantage was that now liturgical music could be sold for profit. If a hymnal was popular, it would make money for the publisher. This phenomenon snowballed over the centuries and became nightmarish once the idea of intellectual property and copyright law took hold in the turn of the 20th century. Nowadays, every church musician's mailboxes are filled with spam and junk catalogs, coaxing one to buy the latest, most relevant, hauntingly striking songs to the life and the worship of your congregation. We are invited to choral readings, workshops, conferences, sponsored by publishers, use this as a marketing device. And I could go on. But rather than drift into a negative appraisal of the modern liturgical practice, let me know that some of the original Reformation hymns we were discussing are still sung today. If you'll take your red hymnals again now from the pew, you can find some notable ones right here. Let's look at two from Luther's German Mass of 1526, and one derived from the Gregorian chant. The two from the German Mass are Allein der Hosse Erde 410 and Allein Gottes Entschuldigung 357. And the chant paraphrase tune is the Advent hymn Nun kommt der Heil und Heil, number 263. So we're going to look at those three in a little bit of detail. Before discussing the German Mass of 1526, it's important to bear in mind that Luther's first liturgical reform was the order of the Latin Mass in 1523. In this document, he did away with lengthy medieval canons and generally made texts and actions more concise. If you read some of these canons, if you're an egghead like me, you read some of these canons, think on and on and on, they're very flowery. I mean, they're only 3 pages long. This is the part of the service where after you sing the song to us before the rite of consecration, there's a few words which in the medieval liturgy is more than a few. Anyway, he got rid of all that and made things more concise. He stipulated plainly, quote, let the old practice continue, let the Mass be celebrated with consecrated vestments with chants and the usual ceremonies in Latin. Luther did not envision a grand sweeping away of the liturgical tradition or the use of Latin, as did Calvin and Zwingli in Switzerland. I think there's a general lumping together of these reforms in the minds of many, but there's a world of difference in the attitudes and liturgical practices between them. Zwingli had a distrust of music as something pleasurable and therefore an obstacle, and banished it from worship altogether. Calvin, too, was suspicious of Haydn and allowed only songs to be sung to simple melodies. Luther, on the other hand, loved music and was an accomplished lutenist and amateur composer. The austere attitudes of Calvin and Zwingli were nothing new. Hippolytus, in the second century, wrote that instruments were not to be used as in Christian worship like the pagans. Christian girls must never play the flute. To this day, Eastern Orthodox Christianity does not employ instrumental music in liturgies, but sings a cappella. Music in Western Christianity employed the use of the organ, but not as an accompaniment to singing hymns as we do today. The new Lutheran hymns in the vernacular were sung unaccompanied as monody, that is, without harmonization. These unison verses were sung in alternatum with verses taken by the choir alone, in polyphony, polyphonic harmony, or by an organ solo in between each verse. This was a device long known to monastic practices and was used widely in worship of Catholic churches and cathedrals where the faithful might join in singing the Latin hymn. Some of these hymns had 8 verses or more. Switching back and forth between organ and choir continued traditional liturgical practice, although now in the vernacular rather than Latin. If the hymns with many verses, like eight verses prolonged by lengthy organ and choral interludes, sounds tedious to your modern sensibilities, as I'm guessing it might, having fielded many a complaint to that effect in my day, it's important to remember that you couldn't just press a button anytime you wanted to hear music and have a choice of what style and repertoire you care to listen to, as we do now. If you wanted to hear music, you had to either make it yourself, or you had to go someplace where others were making it. Church was a place where music making could be experienced on a large scale. These long hymns, that's St. Thomas in Leipzig. These long hymns with eight verses would have been much more engaging under the circumstances rather than complaining that the service was long. One might wish even for more verses to extend the unique musical experience that could be had only on Sundays at church. Luther wrote an Ordo Missae for use in Latin, but then followed it with his German Mass, so this is the time of the German Mass, mostly translated into the vernacular and incorporating new hymn tunes for some of the ordinary. The Sanctus was a notable exception, presumably sung in Latin by the choir. Luther's reform had both and mentality, and not a blanket condemnation of what had come before. This brings up a conflict in the Lutheran Reformation's liturgical and musical tradition. On the one hand, musicologist Richard Taruskin observes that, quote, in keeping with the communitarian ideals of the Reform, the Lutheran Church had first advocated the use of full congregational singing in place of traditional service music, or any music, whether plain song or figure, that required use of a professional choir, and thus created a musical hierarchy. The lay congregation could thus become its own choir, even as the whole congregation of the faithful, not the minister's ordained authority, now constitute the priesthood. End quote. On the other hand, I've already quoted Luther himself as saying that the old practice should continue, vestments, use of Latin, etc. It is a well-documented fact that, from the start, Lutheran churches employed professional singers and maintained choir schools where students received musical training on the highest level. These singers and students sang complex polyphonic choral music both in Latin and German at services. Judging from the music which was being composed by Lutheran cantors to be sung by these professional ensembles, Latin was used well into the 18th century in Lutheran services. In my experience, this is not the impression most Lutherans have about their tradition, yet the scores exist, as do the accounts ledgers. Looking again at the hymns in our hymnal, as I mentioned, let's first consider the line Gott und der Hosei Erde 4:10. So if we turn to that now, this is a metrical paraphrase of a Latin chant. So, the chant goes, Et in terra pax hominibus, voluntatis. And the tune that Luther fashioned was. So you can see how it's a natural divining of one to the other. It's interesting to note that he didn't start with the incipit, or the beginning of the actual text of the in the chant, the Gloria in Excelsis Deo, which would have been chanted alone by a priest. Gloria in Excelsis Deo, and then the part that I just played. It's obvious how the chant was fashioned into triple meter in Southern German. And in the late 17th and 18th century, these metrical chorales were reset in four square rhythms, replacing Renaissance-style syncopations. Triple meters with a slow, stately duple meter and richly harmonized in a new style. Bach refashioned hundreds of chorales in this way. And here is his version of a line Gott und der Hosei Erde. On one of his versions, he has three. Thank you. almost all the chorales were, Bach did that to 270 chorales, so they were all transformed in that way. And this happened, they were played that way from the 18th century through the beginning of the 20th century. And it was then, with a new interest in musicology, that the older original versions came to light and were reintroduced in hymnals, which is why the original version in triple meter is in the hymnal you're holding and not Mike's version. While we're at ELW 410, you are still there, yes. Let's take a look at ELW 409, just because we're there. Kyrie, Lord Father. This is the Kyrie of Luther's hymns, and it also is derived from a chant. It's derived from a troped Gregorian chant, the Kyrie Fons Praecantus. The trope is an additional text added onto or inserted into a pre-existing chant. Sometimes this text was simply added to melismatic parts of the pre-existing tune with a syllabic texture, and that's what happened in this case. But sometimes a new bit of tune was inserted along with the text as a whole. The Kyrie chant we're talking about without the tropes. So this is the text that got filled in, and in your hymnal, it's there. So, Kyrie became. Slightly simplified and with a definite meter to it. I'm fascinated with this stuff, but you're probably not. But the Olam Mortis von Schulte, which is do any of you remember which number Olam Gvatis was? 357? Okay, thank you. And it was first published by Joachim Schluter and Geistliche Lehrer in Rostock in 1531 with a text and tune by Nikolaus Statius. And Statius wrote a number of well-known chorale texts. It was a Renaissance dance-like tune triple meter. However, it appeared in a slightly different version a few years later in a Strasbourg hymnal in around 1540, and this version is the version that's in our hymnal. But the first version is. day for the German Mass. And but it was replaced by Luther's own Christe de Lambortus from 196, which we sang this morning as the August day, if any of you remember. And that is 196 in the hymn, Christe de Lambortus. But the Lambortus of Schuldig is still sung at Lent's Passion Time, and as was the case with All Glory Be to God on High, the Lambortus was reworded by Bach. Let me see if I can find his 18th century version. Bach actually wrote a number of beautiful, he liked this tune, he used it a lot. So it's actually a triple choir. There's two double choirs of soprano, alto, tenor, bass, and then there's a third choir that's just the boy sopranos. So I'd like to play a little of that so you can hear that. Video because the way they have the choirs placed, it's really easy to see the how the music is arranged. So let's skip forward. Oh. that was tricky. Advent hymn, Nun kommt der Heiland, which is 263. It's based on the Latin chant hymn, Veni Redemptor Gentium, by Ambrose. And it was printed in the Erfurt Enchiridion, which is the Hamlet, of 1524. And this is the second Lutheran hymn after the Achtlied. The chorale was used as a prominent hymn for the first Sunday of Advent for centuries. And in fact, last year we did it for the first Sunday of Advent here at St. Francis. You can see in the comparison score how the chant, you can't because I don't have that slide. But let me play for you. I don't have it because that slide didn't make it. Is very, very similar to the chant. So now I want to go through and listen to a number of examples through the centuries of how that tune has been used. We'll just go chronologically. We'll start with the early Lutheran composers and go all the way into the 20th century. Just little snippets of each. So this is from a Cantillon by Schein. So this would have been one of the verses that might have been sung in alternatum by the choir. And this is what it might have sounded like. Schütz, who was in the generation just before Bach. So you can see in this, there's now a new style with a soloist, like opera. And strings and sackbuttons, the melody within that texture. I like these videos with the score. Thank you. it's sort of stodges and stately, but it has like a flows. He's an earlier composer than Bach, and this is sort of a Renaissance orchestra coming into rendering with a big Venetian polychoral sound to it. So, and the new Baroque idea of small ensemble versus large ensemble. Small ensemble. He liked this tune, I tell you. So he wrote three organ chorales in the Leipzig, eight of the 18 Leipzig chorales, three of them were based on this tune. And then he also wrote some other ones as well. But this is a full organ with the melody and the pedal. This is a hard piece. Leipzig chorales for organ that he wrote was transcribed by a late 19th, early 20th century Italian composer named Busoni, and he transcribed a lot of Bach's music for piano. And so now I'm going to play Vladimir Horowitz is going to play Bach in the manner of a salon selection. But you know, it works. For an organist to hear it played that way, it's kind of weird. And then it turns up in some enlightened places. The 1948 classic film, The Red Shoes, uses it in the ballet sequence. Let's see if I can find where that is in here. Thank you. there's a, like a whole variation, orchestral variation on the tune. And then finally, a contemporary group in Berlin that is a jazz choir. Didn't know much about it, but I really like. It's really good. So I'm going to skip around. They start with just the. I like that because these tunes are still in musicians' ears and are around and pop up in the weirdest places sometimes. So,
let's go back to the.
So, the chorale tradition was carried on in the 19th century. Notably by Felix Mendelssohn, who brought to light the works of Bach. Bach, in his day, was not a major musical figure, but a working musician only known locally. After his death, his music was forgotten. His scores became what I like to call backstacks music, meaning that only egg-headed musicians ever took the trouble to go to the back of the stacks of the libraries to which they were regularly relegated. Mendelssohn recognized the genius of the writer and gave the now famous revival concert of Bach's St. Matthew Passion in 1829. The concert sold out and many were turned away. Interest in Bach's music peaked, with the 1830 being the 300th anniversary of the Augsburg Confession and a rising nationalism in Germany. Thus the scores of Bach were dusted off, and with it Lutheran chorales. Mendelssohn himself used chorale melodies in some of his works, his most famous being his Fifth Symphony. But he also wrote 8 chorale cantatas, and chorale tunes appear in some of his oratorios, notably St. Paul, uses be sure to relation to the words. And in his organ sonatas, Mendelssohn was an organist and considered his organ sonatas to be some of his finest compositions, and no one has disagreed with him yet. So you might be saying to yourself at this point, that's all terribly fascinating or not, but why is Luther's reform a cultural revolution, as you stated in the title of this talk? And maybe you want me to cut to the chase, so I will. In one concise fell swoop, it is this. Luther created a populist mentality, which is non-existent prior, where all people, both rich and poor, educated and illiterate, able to and expected to join in making music together through an established repertoire of chorale melodies. At first, this may not seem like much, but it's like a snowball that becomes an avalanche as it rolls along. Roland Barthes was on to something when he suggested that Lutheranism inaugurated a culture of listening. Luther certainly developed a practice in which music took on a more highly charged value, consolidating the drama and struggles of belief within the mind of the believer rather than the multi-sensory panoply of Catholicism. Bach related the presence of God and His grace specifically to music as, quote, something that cannot be seen or touched, but which permeates the believer's world and mind. Scripture and faith coalesce in the believer's own mind through the practice of listening. Modern music culture was inaugurated through this intensification of listening, by which music ultimately became elevated autonomous art of what is often termed as classical music. John Butt writes in his article, The Reformation, Classical Music's Punk Monk, quote, if one thread of the Reformation and Counter-Reformation led towards the intensification of the individual sense of self, it also provided the beginnings of community performance and listening. It was, after all, Luther who essentially inaugurated congregational singing in the church. And this trend soon became adopted towards the psalm singing of the Reformed traditions and later Anglicanism and Methodism. Catholicism. These singing traditions lay behind the amateur choral societies of the late 18th century, but they also enabled listeners to play a more active part in listening to the music sung by the specialists. A listener immersed in Lutheran tradition participates in the chorales of a Bach passion, even if she is not actually singing at that moment. Prior to the 18th century, instrumental music was mostly incidental and not the main focus of establishment. Towards the end of the 18th century, European music and culture began to rebel against the privacy of text as the essence of musical sense of expression, and music emerged as an art liberated from text, but preserving something of the intensity and contemplation of religious practice. The symphonic works of Beethoven exemplify this contemplative and spiritual idea in instrumental music, and were seminal in the style and attitudes concerning music in the 19th century and early 20th century. All this to say that the concert experience of the 19th and 20th centuries could not have occurred without Reformation's attitudes and ideas. The subscription concert is a prime example. Yes, they do have a symphony in South Dakota. For centuries, music making by specialists could only be afforded and heard in the course of aristocracy. Beginning in the 18th century, up until the present day, the emerging middle class found that they too could afford to have this sort of musical ensemble in a collective. Small contributions could equal the sums previously available only at the benevolence of an aristocratic court. Mozart was one of the first to shun the control of the benefactor system and try to make a go of it through popular subscriptions. He went bankrupt, but nonetheless. This idea and new system were a natural outcome of the sensibilities of the Reformation. In closing, I thought it would be fun and also informative to trace the use of one chorale melody through 500 years since the beginning of the Reformation. The obvious choice is Ein feste Burg. In your hymnal, this is 503 and 504. So I'm going to play. Recording of Ein feste Burg as it would have been sung at the time of Luther without any harmonic accompaniment. My first organ teacher was Finnish, And he came from a little town in Finland, his parents, and he used to say his mother would always say that they didn't have an organ in their church. He says, well, we don't need an organ to sing hymns. So this is what they did, you know? And here's a... So that it's a full harmonization. This would have been the alternatum part, sung by choir professional musicians. And I'm going to play a little more of it so you can listen, because they have sackbuts playing along with the singers. I don't know if you know this, but it makes for fuller sound. So he was the first of many Germans who went to Venice to study, and Venice was sort of the hot spot of music at the time. And he studied with the Gabrielli's, and Andrea, at the time he was there, was the Maestro of Capella at St. Mark's, and was a very well-known musician in all of Europe. And they had a style of music called cori spezzanti, or special choirs. So that they would have two and three choirs singing all at the same time and then separately. And so they made these various textures, what we call polychoral sound. And Luther, Hassler, used this in some of his compositions in German. Well, this is not one of them. This is an interesting video because it's a high school choir. It's a Christian high school choir in North Carolina somewhere. And they murder this piece, but they do it so sweetly. And you can still get an idea of what it is. It usually goes a little slower and not so pointillistic. Liszt heard that piece and transcribed it for the organ, and it actually came out pretty well. Thank you. Rockettato. I know, I shouldn't leave that out. Somebody who I've always liked because he was sort of a gruff character. His name is Max Reger, and he was a post-romantic. He lived at the end of the 19th, beginning of the 20th century, and he was a professor at the Conservatory in Leipzig, and was a conductor and a composer, and also played the organ. So he did write He wrote a big concert piece on Ein Fest der Burg. He gave a concert once, and there was the reigning musical critic of the age was Eduard Hanslick, who was a philosopher and a man of letters. And he lived in Vienna and wrote extensively on music. And his book, Beautiful Music, is sort of the text for musical aesthetics. He was very conservative and thought that Wagner was just horrendous, and that we should, you know, keep the strict symphonic forms, and that all these leitmotifs were nonsense, et cetera, et cetera. So Reger was a Wagnerian, and so Reger gave a concert of his music, and Hanslick gave a review of it, and not a very favorable one. And so, this is famous. Reger wrote Hanslick a quick note. He said, "Herr Hanslick, your review is before me. I am sitting in the smallest room in my house. Soon, it will be behind me." Have a soft spot for Siegfried Kargiela, who was just a few years older, newer. He died in 1933, so he was the generation after Reger, but was also a contemporary Reger, and also taught at the Leipzig Conservatory, and was also a composer and conductor and organist. But he had a more international style and was very interested in French Impressionism, and as well as in the more chromatic harmonies of the Wagnerian school. And especially after World War II, there was a very sort of nationalistic attitude in Germany, and his music was not recognized or played because it wasn't. Had this more international flavor. And this is also the era of the theater organ, and I think, that shows in some of his music, Matera has its style, and sometimes it permeates more than one area of music. Seven pieces called Seven Pastels on Lake Constance, which are just crazy impressionistic with all these different colors and things. And he went so far as to put a soprano organist in the swell box of the organ and had the box closed so that she would be hidden back there. It would be this box of theory coming from nowhere, you know. So Krzysztof Penderecki, who is a contemporary composer, a Polish composer, very well known, wrote just a couple years ago in 2005 a piece based on Ein Fest der Burg, but there's no recording, so I can't show it to you, but it's for strings and brass and choir. So I thought in closing maybe we should sing a verse of Ein Fest der Burg all together in Lutheran style. So let's do that 504 in your hymnals. Downstairs, yes?
Yes.
You do? Okay, so right downstairs, meet and greet. Thank you.